Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bones, Inside and Out, by Roy A. Meals, M.D. Narrated by L.J. Ganser. Introduction. Consider the shortcomings of everyday building materials. Mud mushes. When it dries out, it crumbles. Limestone, granite, concrete, brick, and china don't crumble, but they are brittle, and their weight and bulk limit their usefulness for building, especially for things that are supposed to move. Metal makes for lighter construction, and if you bend metal a bit, it springs back, which is usually fine. But bend metal some more, and it stays bent, which can be bad. Plastics are environmentally unfriendly. Wood is good because it is a bit flexible, easy to join, relatively lightweight, and biodegradable, but it can rot or burn. Other building materials used by living organisms also have their shortcomings. Shells are heavy, which makes it difficult for snails and clams to move quickly. Lobsters are fast, and beetles can even fly. But their thin, lightweight, crunchy exterior support system needs to be vacated and replaced periodically in order for the owner to grow. All this leads to bone. Not only is bone manufactured on-site, it is also lightweight, durable, and responsive to changing conditions. A bridge made of steel cannot double its length or its carrying capacity. But bone both grows and responds to stresses. Furthermore, bone mends itself. A shattered brick or a broken spoon, be it made of metal, plastic, or wood, cannot do that. Not only is bone the world's best structural support, it is also the world's largest import-export bank, a repository of vital elements, especially calcium, on which our lives depend. Despite all of its marvels, hardly anybody has ever seen or wants to see living bone, especially their own. So bone, regardless of its superlative features, lives in seclusion and does not get the respect it deserves. For example, what image pops into your mind when you think of bone? Is it a Georgia O'Keeffe painting of a cow skull toasting in the sun? That desert depiction, dry, white, timeless, does not begin to do bone justice. Furthermore, annoyance and even disdain for bone arise when one tries to get that last morsel of meat off a rack of lamb or a beef T-bone. Rushing toward dessert, you probably have never paused to marvel at that ring of bone centered in your ham steak, to understand why drumsticks are thicker at the ends than in the middle, or to ponder why some fish bones are rubbery and wishbones are brittle. Cynics who remain unconvinced that bone is the best building material may even ask, if bones are all that great, why don't snails have any? Or bees? I will answer these questions and many more as the story of bone unfolds. Although bone is ubiquitous and versatile, it is rarely seen in its living state, and hence it is a bit mysterious. Then, after this marvelous mystery material has finished serving and protecting its original owner, it reveals itself in myriad places and for myriad purposes, sometimes hundreds of millions of years later. Bone has much to teach us about Earth's history and the course of animal life on the planet. Additionally, from the dawn of civilization, humankind has repurposed bone to serve and protect, even to amuse and inspire. Bone's durability and ubiquity make its revealed state as interesting as its concealed state. By the end of the book, you'll be convinced that it is the world's best building material. Part 1. Bone Concealed. Chapter 1. Bone's Unique Composition and Varied Structure. The prominent Greek physician and philosopher Galen wrote that bone, because of its pale color, was made of sperm. 1,000 years later, Avicenna, a Persian astronomer, physician, and prolific writer, thought that bone was made of earth because it was cold and dry. Now, another 1,000 years later, different notions prevail. Avicenna did, however, note that the best way to understand the skeleton was to separate it from the rest of the body, which is still good advice. To get to know bone, we should separate it down to its organic chemistry. 5 carbon atoms can combine with 1 each of oxygen and nitrogen, along with several of hydrogen, to make proline, an amino acid. Amino acids are the essential building blocks of life, and humans both make proline from scratch and break it down by digesting proteins. Certain cells then assemble a proline-rich mix of amino acids into a chain to make a molecule of collagen, which is the most common protein in our bodies. The strand, at this point, faintly resembles an ultra-microscopic strand of limp spaghetti. An extra hydrogen and oxygen atom then attach to many of the proline molecules. This causes the chain to kink sharply at regular intervals, and it now looks more like a minuscule piece of corkscrew pasta. Three of these corkscrews nest together to form a collagen molecule, which even at this super sub-microscopic level is strong and stable because the nooks in one strand nest into the crannies of the adjacent ones. Collagen molecule assembly occurs in several different kinds of cells, including the type that makes bone. These are the osteoblasts, from the Greek words for bone and germinator. After forming a collagen molecule, the osteoblast pushes this chemical mechanical wonder through its cell membrane, out into the minute space between the cells. In this new location, collagen molecules not only join end to end, but also snuggle side to side to make a multi-strand fiber. The collagen molecules are so thin that it would take 17 hours of adding one collagen molecule every second to make a stack as tall as the page of a book is thick. And even though the molecules are much longer than they are thick, it would take 300,000 of them placed end to end to span the space inside a typed letter O. The collagen fibers are locked together both by mechanical nesting, nook cranny, and by chemical, sticky, pasta-like bonds. If you consider how strong three tiers of Legos would be, if you smeared them with superglue before snapping them together, then you begin to understand the strength of collagen fibers. When stretched, these tough amino acid chains are stronger than equally thick filaments of steel. That is all the chemistry needed for now. Let's take a minute to understand the connection between limeys, shoe leather, furniture glue, and jiggly gelatin desserts. Remember the hydrogen-oxygen appendages on proline molecules? Vitamin C catalyzes those attachments. Without them, no tight corkscrewing occurs. A deficiency of vitamin C leads to faulty collagen production, which is the cause of scurvy. Symptoms include bleeding gums and easy bruising. Early mariners were at sea for months and endured diets almost entirely devoid of fresh fruits and vegetables. British sailors learned to squeeze fresh limes into their fetid drinking water to mask its taste. By doing so, their collagen production returned to normal, and the sailors discovered serendipitously that a lime a day kept the scurvy away. Another collagen connection relates to shoe leather, which is tanned cowhide. It is tough because the tanner adds chemicals to the vats that increase the number of weld points among the collagen fibers in the hide. Just the opposite is true for paintball covers, medicine capsules, hide-based furniture glue, gelatin desserts, and gummy bears. They are all made from partially unlinked collagen, which comes from boiled byproducts of meat and leather production. This is where the expression, sending a horse to the glue factory, came from. Warning, do not read a description of gelatin manufacture if you want to enjoy your next marshmallow. Collagen resists stretching. It is the main constituent of tendons, which convert muscle contractions into joint motions, and ligaments, which keep joints properly aligned. Consider standing on your toes. If your Achilles tendons were rubbery, they would stretch like bungee cords when you contracted your calf muscles, and your heels would remain on the floor. This would be bad. You could never jump. Or consider putting your fingertips on your cheek and stretching your fingers away from your palm. If your ligaments were not tough, you could push your fingers away until your fingernails touched the back of your hand. This would be unsightly. Some people naturally have ligaments that are extremely stretchable. These so-called double-jointed contortionists enjoy demonstrating their great flexibility while watching the rest of us wince. You may have considered the description of collagen irrelevant, since collagen is tough and does not stretch, and we know intuitively that bone is not stretchy. Rather, bone is rigid and resists getting mashed flat. It resists compression, scientific parlance for mashing, because it consists of calcium crystals deposited on a meshwork of, you guessed it, collagen, like plaster on lath. To prove it for yourself, buy a pack of chicken drumsticks. Fillet several of them and soak the bones in vinegar for several weeks. Cook the others, enjoy a chicken dinner, and then bake the leftover bones at 250 degrees Fahrenheit for several hours. The ones soaked in vinegar become rubbery and bendable because the vinegar dissolves the calcium from the collagen meshwork. The baked one becomes brittle and fragile, like sticks of chalk, because the heat destroys the collagen. Chemistry books note that calcium crystals come in various forms. These include calcium chloride, road de-icer, calcium citrate, water softener, diet supplement, calcium carbonate, antacid tablets, chalk, coral, eggshell, calcium sulfate, gypsum, plaster of Paris, and calcium hydroxide, slaked lime. If you add a phosphorus compound to calcium hydroxide under the right conditions, you get hydroxyapatite, which might be a new word for you. It has nothing to do with hydrox cookies or appetite, even for marshmallows or other gelatin delectables. Rather, hydroxyapatite is the principal calcium crystal of bone. People might consider you a bit weird if you tossed the word out at a cocktail party, but it is what our bone crystals are called, and hydroxyapatite is holding you off the floor. So let's learn a little about it. In the 1780s, a German mineralogist recognized the apatite crystal as a distinct species, whereas previously it had been confused with other minerals or repeatedly identified as new ones. He named it for its deceptive nature, apatite in German, from the Greek apati, meaning deceit. The mineral exists in various forms. With a water ion attached, it becomes hydroxyapatite. Particularly if you are watching your weight, understand that bone constitutes about 15% of our body mass, and that bone is about one-third collagen and two-thirds calcium phosphorus crystals. Accordingly, a 160-pound person possesses 24 pounds of bone, 8 pounds of collagen, and 16 pounds of hydroxyapatite. That's enough to fill a carry-on roller bag. Not that you would want to try to slip it past TSA, but at least you have a mental image now of one's bone mass. Imagine some osteoblasts in a bread pan, floating around in a nutritious broth of water and oxygen. The osteoblasts follow their genetically programmed urge to manufacture and secrete collagen and hydroxyapatite molecules. Voila! The calcium crystals deposit themselves on the meshwork of collagen, and we get bone. The osteoblasts essentially seal themselves in cocoons of bone, where they become osteocytes, mature bone cells. They maintain the bone's structure but do not contribute much to further construction or to any destruction. Various chemical messengers, mainly hormones from the pituitary, thyroid, and testes or ovaries, affect the vigor with which osteoblasts produce bone. Other nearby cells produce chemical messengers known as growth factors, which also consist of amino acid chains. Several of these growth factors can whip the osteoblasts into a bone-forming frenzy and even convert several other types of cells into bone-forming cells if necessary. When enough osteoblasts have done their job encasing themselves next to one another in cocoons of collagen-reinforced hydroxyapatite, the nutritional broth in the bread pan turns rock solid. The lump would be about the same density and strength as an adobe brick. Can you imagine our ancestors successfully avoiding pursuit by lions if their bones were made of adobe? Ah, but consider further, the lions would have similarly formed bones, so it would have been a boring slow-motion chase. Of course, that is not what happened evolutionarily. To understand what did happen, we need to consider some mechanical principles, which will explain why most flat bones, for example, skull and breastbone, have two layers of compact bone sandwiching a spongy interior, and why the long bones in the arms and legs are cylindrical, just like tubes in a bicycle frame. First, consider the thin flat bones. The skull protects the brain, and the breastbone and ribs protect the heart and lungs from direct blows. The inner and outer surfaces of these plates are hard, dense, and smooth, and they resist bending and puncture. The spongy interior is rigid. Think frozen sponge, lightweight, and adds strength, identical to the structure of corrugated cardboard. Now, consider the tubular bones. To appreciate the beauty of their structure, first think about a wooden board that is 10 feet long, 18 inches wide, and 2 inches thick. We could use it to span an 8-foot-wide chasm and safely walk across. A little springy, perhaps, but we would make it. To eliminate the springiness, we could turn the plank up sideways and tiptoe across on the 2-inch-wide edge. The bridge would be a lot narrower, but far more rigid. In these two arrangements, the board does not change its dimensions or physical properties, but when turned on edge, it has 18 inches of material arranged vertically to resist bending, rather than just 2 inches. That is why the floor joists in a wood frame house are set on edge. Otherwise, the floor would be a trampoline. You could make floor joists really thick and lay them flat, but by the time you got them thick enough so that they were not springy, the floor would be so heavy and expensive that the entire project would likely collapse, both mechanically and financially. How do engineers make joists, beams, and girders maximally efficient? In other words, how do they achieve the largest effect while using the least amount of material and effort? They choose beam designs that, when viewed end-on, have the shape of a capital I, the I-beam. We could discuss the principle of the I-beam using formulas that contain Greek letters, but here is a pain-free overview. The portions of a beam or joist that contribute the most to its stiffness are the portions that are near its edges. For example, you could start with a rectangular beam and remove much of the material that is on its sides. The beam would maintain most of its original strength, but with greatly reduced weight and cost. The good news about an I-beam is that it efficiently resists bending from top-down forces. The bad news is that it is not particularly strong in resisting side-to-side forces or twisting forces. A beam equally resistant to forces from the top and side would look something like a skinny iron cross. This beam, however, would still be weak when resisting forces applied obliquely from the 2, 5, 8, or 11 o'clock positions. To resist forces coming from any direction, the beam would have to be a composite of numerous I-beams arranged in a circle. If the outer flanges of each portion of the composite beam became joined together, the middle portions could be removed without greatly weakening the structure. What's left? A cylinder, which can resist bending and twisting forces from all directions. Its hollow interior spares weight and material, and an identically dimensioned solid rod would not greatly add to the structure's stiffness. That is the beauty of bicycle frames, ski poles, and, you guessed it, bones. Our long bones are basically tubes, hollow, light, and bend-resistant in all directions. Note, too, that most cylindrical bones flare at the ends, where they are covered with cartilage, which is another connective tissue, this time formed by interspersing large molecules on a collagen meshwork. In the case of bone, the plaster molecules are the hard, compression-resistant hydroxyapatite crystals. For cartilage, the clinging molecules are springy and attract water. These molecules' sponge-like features bestow on cartilage its slippery property, allowing the jointed bone ends to glide nearly frictionless over one another. The structure and function of cartilage are as fascinating as they are for bone. But cartilage will have to wait for a book of its own. For bone lovers, all we need to know is that cartilage is soft and slippery compared with compact bone. The flares on the ends of long bones protect the delicate cartilage in two ways. First, the flaring increases the area of contact between the ends of adjacent bones, thereby reducing the pressure in any one spot that the cartilage must endure. Second, the flare consists mostly of spongy bone, which is a bit springy and provides a cushioning effect for the pressure-sensitive cartilage. You have probably noticed that the central cavity inside a long bone's hard, dense cylinder is not entirely empty. This leads us to the nature and purpose of both types of bone, compact and spongy, hard on the outside, springy on the inside, like a Tootsie Pop or a loaf of crusty French bread. Bone's outer surface is mechanically sound and does our heavy lifting. The spongy central cavity bone adds some strength and support to the hard surface, especially near the ends. Filling the spaces created by the spongy bone are two types of marrow cells, red and yellow. Red prevails in early life and is present particularly at the ends of our cylindrical bones. Red marrow has a rich blood supply and is responsible for making new blood cells, roughly 500 billion a day. Yellow marrow is mostly gelatinous fat, and with increasing age, it constitutes a greater proportion of bone's interior. Some gourmands find yellow marrow from beef bones delicious and will scrape, chew, crack, and even slurp them to get it. This is what Henry David Thoreau meant when he went to the woods to live deep and suck all the marrow out of life. That is pretty much what I do with Tootsie Pops. Some birds have entirely marrowless thigh and arm bones, which are key parts of their breathing system. These cavities momentarily store inhaled air before it passes through the lungs and back out the mouth. Some dinosaurs had similar hollow bones that also likely aided respiration. These hollow bones in ancient dinosaurs and in modern birds strengthen the evidence that birds developed from those ancient reptiles. Inquiring minds may now be wondering, how does blood get through a bone's dense cylinder to nourish its spongy interior? A hole passing directly through the bone, one large enough to accommodate sizable blood vessels, would cause problems. Such an opening would weaken the cylinder and greatly reduce its ability to resist bending and twisting forces. Fractures would easily occur. Instead, multiple pinhole tunnels take long, diagonal paths through the cylinder's wall. Each one contains a minuscule artery and vein. Some bones have more of these nutrient passageways than others. The hip bone and one bone in each the wrist and ankle are noted for not having any passages along major portions. This makes healing fractures in those regions problematic because the supply lines for delivering the building materials are limited. Curious types may also be pondering what the purpose of bone is in the first place. Consider the motto of the Los Angeles Police Department, to protect and serve. From an orthopedic surgeon's point of view, the cops have the order wrong. We think service, then protection. Neurosurgeons and cardiologists might feel differently. Your skull protects your brain, and your ribs and breastbone protect other assorted innards. But the really great bones, the ones whose well-being orthopedists oversee, are the service providers, spine, pelvis, limbs. Each bone's unique shape allows it to provide service and, in some instances, protection as well. Size aside, there are remarkable similarities between the shapes of analogous bones in most mammals, birds, and even dinosaurs. Take, for example, an elephant's shin bone and a chicken's corresponding drumstick bone. Each is relatively narrow in the middle and flares out at both ends to contribute to the knee and ankle joints. The broad ends serve to widely disperse weight-bearing forces and also provide adequate surface area for attachment of ligaments, which prevent the joints from flopping around. If someone were to ask you how many bones there are in the human body, please do not blurt out 206. Though 206 is the widely accepted number, in reality, the answer is complicated. Consider first that humans vary from one another in facial features, hair color, height, and shoe size. Similar variations also exist beneath the skin. Nerves, tendons, arteries, and bones all have their unique arrangements. Their precise location and size inside my body say little about their precise arrangement in yours. To solve the bone count riddle, we have to address five key questions. Who, what, when, where, why? First, who is counting? A paleontologist brushing sand off long-buried fossils may miss some tiny bones. These include sesamoids, which are small bones embedded in tendons and found adjacent to joints throughout the body. Sesamoids, so named because they resemble sesame seeds, though in humans they are larger, more like the size of capers, help to distribute pressure evenly as we grip objects with our hands and bear weight on our feet. Some people do not have any sesamoid bones in their hands or feet, yet they manage as well as those who have 20. Consequently, we call these bones accessories. You may want to include at least some of them in your count. Next, what counts as a bone? The kneecap is a giant sesamoid. It is always included in the favored 206. So is a pea-sized wrist bone. Most people have 24 ribs, 12 on each side of the chest, but others have 26, and they don't get extra credit. Three tiny bones in each ear count toward our total, but sesamoids in the feet are left out, as are bean-sized accessory bones around the hip, knee, and ankle. When do we count? Babies are born with around 270 bones, and then some slowly fuse together. Initially, the plate-like skull bones can move against one another and shift the head's shape to facilitate delivery. Then it's a normal occurrence for the skull bones to fuse together in order to protect the brain. In infancy, many bones in the wrists and ankles do not yet contain enough calcium to block X-ray beams, and thus don't make shadows during imaging. There are also wrist and ankle bones that sometimes, for no good reason, fuse with neighboring bones, further complicating our count. Where do we look? Different books offer different perspectives on bone count. Depending on its intended audience, one book might not show any sesamoid bones, while another will identify any bone that has ever been described. Finally, why bother? For different reasons, the number matters to medical students, surgeons, and paleontologists. Consequently, your best answer to the bone count question is that nobody really knows, and that you're not going to expose yourself to enough radiation to find out. All of the 200-plus bones in the human body have names, which helps us to describe them when we cannot actually hold them and point. Because Latin was the original language of Western science, most bones received Latin names, some of which were derived from Greek. All were purely descriptive and self-explanatory if you spoke Latin. For example, the shoulder blade is mostly a flat triangle. An early anatomist picked one up, pondered, and decided it resembled a shovel's blade. He named it scapula, Latin for shovel. The eight wrist bones are another good example of labeling simplicity. First only identified by number, these bones later received Latin names, including scaphoid, lunate, triquetrum, and pisiform. The names simply describe the bones' shapes, boat, crescent moon, three corners, and pea, respectively. Not only do the bones have names that are vaguely descriptive, so do all their bumps, ridges, and nooks. The top of your shoulder blade is the acromion, derived from the Greek akro, meaning highest, as in Acropolis, high city, and from omion, meaning shoulder. The tip of your elbow is your olecranon. It comes from the Greek olene, for elbow, plus kranion, for head. The hip joint's deep socket in the pelvis is the acetabulum, named for its resemblance to a vinegar cup, acetum for vinegar, plus abulum for container. The bumps on both sides of your ankle? They are malleoli, derived from malleus, or hammer. What were they thinking? Doctors today buy into the Greek and Latin naming tradition both necessarily and willingly. Using uniform terminology, medical professionals can understand lectures and journal articles from around the world. Consciously or unconsciously, perhaps doctors also believe that tossing around ancient terminology distinguishes the medical wizards from the uneducated masses. This makes knowledge privileged and hence valuable. When bone wizards gather, we like to regale one another with our experiences treating the calcaneus, those condyles, and that coracoid. But after listening to this book, you won't be fooled. Consider the awe-inspiring foramen magnum, the 1-inch diameter hole at the base of the skull from whence the spinal cord emerges. Foramen magnum sounds grand and important, perhaps even a bit magical. It translates, however, as big hole. Rather than keeping things murky, songwriter James Weldon Johnson wrote simple lyrics for the spiritual Dem Bones. Conversely, had the composer been an anatomist, we would likely be singing, "The tibia is connected to the patella is connected to the femur." Such connections are not unique to humans. When I visit a natural history museum, I marvel at the similarity of skeletal structures between widely diverse animals. This is not apparent at the zoo, where an elephant's forefoot is obviously a far cry from a bat's wing. But looking at their exposed bones reveals a similar general organization. Skeletal adaptations between species allow the elephant's foot to bear tremendous weight and the bat's wing to carry its owner aloft, yet their bones reflect a common ancestry. Nonetheless, some animals have unique and interesting bones that humans do not have. I'll mention 5, none of which are numbered among the usual 206 belonging to humans. Each bone demonstrates a special enhancement that contributes to its owner's success. I will move from the familiar to the bizarre. Some biologists must have finished their Thanksgiving dinner and asked themselves, "We all know how a turkey's wishbone serves us, but what purpose does it serve a turkey?" From a structural perspective, even if you are an expert turkey carver, it has probably escaped you that the wishbone is both collarbones fused together. That, however, does not explain its function. So some enterprising biologists rigged up a system to have starlings fly in a wind tunnel hooked up to an X-ray machine to reveal images of wishbones in action. As you know, turkey and chicken wishbones are a bit springy. It is the same for starlings. With every powerful downstroke of the bird's wings, the ends of the wishbone move away from each other and absorb energy. Then with the upstroke, which does not need to be as strong, the wishbone springs back to its resting shape and aids the efficiency of flying. Some toucans and owls, however, do not have wishbones and are still capable of strong flight. Conversely, cranes and falcons have rigid wishbones that do not facilitate flight, but their wishbones may help with breathing. Maybe this explains why the turkey became traditional Thanksgiving fare. A roasted toucan or crane would not provide the same after-dinner excitement. Some dinosaurs, including Tyrannosaurus rex, also had wishbones, but humans were not around at the time to consider roasting a T-Rex, much less making a wish on the remains. The second adaptation also links dinosaurs and birds: hollow bones for breathing. Some dinosaurs took the concept further for sounding. They had skulls with cavernous bony crests extending back over the tops of their heads. These hollows connected with the nostrils and throat, and the round trip distance for a breath of air could be as much as 10 feet. Investigators have proposed that this constituted a resonating chamber, which the reptile used to produce and amplify low-pitched calls. The third special bone is a flat ring that is embedded in the white of the eye of some birds and other reptiles, including dinosaurs. It surrounds the eyeball and tends to give the skeleton a scholarly look. It probably helps support the shape of the eye. Nobody knows for sure. The fourth is a set of bones, the gastral basket, also possessed by a variety of prehistoric birds and other reptiles, including T-Rex. Crocodiles and a lizard-like New Zealand creature are the sole owners currently. A gastral basket looks like an oven rack set of extra ribs at belly level, except that they are not attached to the rest of the skeleton. The gastral basket provided shield-like protection to the owner's soft underbelly and may have contributed to breathing, to flight, or to both. Nothing is in doubt about the function of the fifth special bone. It supports the penis during erection. It is present in various mammals, including dogs, cats, raccoons, walruses, sea lions, and even gorillas and chimps, but not humans. The penis bone allows for prolonged intercourse, which is the necessary strategy for ensuring paternity of offspring when suitable females are encountered infrequently. Its shape varies from rod-like to fantastic. Its size varies from tiny in small monkeys to over 2 feet long in sea lions and walruses. I have seen one that had fractured mid-shaft and then healed. Poor boy. Females of species that harbor penis bones generally have clitoris bones, although much smaller. In this chapter, we have covered a lot of territory, beginning with specific arrangements of proline molecules and calcium atoms, chemically, mechanically, and anatomically. Different bones provide unique and varied services for their owners. To do so, they continuously respond to chemical and mechanical influences, and through the ages they have competed with other skeletal support systems. Let's see how bone manages these challenges. Chapter 2. Bones, Life, and Relatives. An infant's shin bone is approximately 3 inches long. In adults, it is about 6 times that, depending on one's height. Throughout life, all bones maintain their unique shapes, but from fetal beginnings to the end of adolescence, they enlarge in all dimensions. How? Imagine a growing twig, which lengthens by continuously adding cells at its end. Bones, however, are capped with cartilage. If, like a twig, the bone grew longer by merely growing a thicker cartilage cap, a teenager's growing shin bone would be primarily cartilage. It would not be sufficiently strong and rigid to withstand the forces sustained by standing, much less skateboarding. What actually happens when bone grows is nothing short of spectacular. Imagine spearing a small square of slippery banana peel to represent freely gliding cartilage onto the end of a growing twig. As the twig grows longer, the banana peel gets pushed ahead. The same concept applies to our bones. The cartilage caps remain relatively thin, but get pushed ahead as growing bone fills in behind it. The extent of an individual's bone growth is partially the result of the person's unique genetic makeup. For example, tall children are usually the product of tall parents. If the genes go awry, bones may end up particularly short or particularly long, and an orthopedist may need to intervene. The extent of bone growth is also partially controlled by nutrition. Americans, in response to ample food, are taller now than they were 200 years ago. The rate of bone growth is also influenced by hormones, which account for growth spurts experienced in puberty. The area beneath the cartilage cap on the end of a bone is called the growth plate. Stimulated by hormones, it rapidly produces new bone cells during growth and pushes the cartilage cap ahead. The growth plate eventually burns out and disappears in late adolescence, typically sooner in girls than in boys. Growth plates on different bones fade away at different times during maturation, but always in a predictable sequence. Therefore, from an X-ray of a growing person's hand, orthopedists and radiologists can determine a growing person's age and time to skeletal maturity according to which growth plates remain active. Also, anthropologists use the presence or absence of growth plates in various bones as a determinant of age at death. During periods of rapid growth, when growth plates are producing bone at warp speed, the new growth is particularly weak and vulnerable to fracture. These fractures almost always heal, but some injuries may irreversibly damage the growth plate. The consequences can vary and depend on the specific bone that has been injured and the age of its owner. If a 16-year-old martial artist fractured a finger bone through its growth plate and the bone stopped growing, a 16th of an inch short of normal, the hand's function and appearance would be entirely normal. But if an 8-year-old skateboarder broke his thigh bone just above his knee and the growth plate gave up the ghost, his leg could be as much as 4 inches shorter than its mate by the end of adolescence, producing major functional and self-image issues. Repeated impact injuries, rather than all of a sudden growth plate fractures, are also problematic. Consider preteen female gymnasts. When performing vault and floor exercises, these athletes run at top speed, leap, and land forcefully on their wrists before flipping and twisting back onto their feet. Over time, these repeated impacts can cause the major growth plate in each forearm to stop functioning. Because the other bone in each forearm continues growing, the ensuing length mismatch may cause wrist pain and perhaps even a career-ending deformity. Our longest bones, those in the thigh, lower leg, upper arm, and forearm, have growth plates on both ends. But the growth plate on one end of each bone contributes more to that bone's ultimate length than does the one at the other end. The upper arm and lower leg bones grow mostly from the ends closest to the body's trunk, while the bones in the forearm and thigh lengthen predominantly from the ends farthest away from the trunk. Because these growth plates have greater or lesser effect on the ultimate length of the bone, orthopedists use a simple trick to remember which growth plates, if injured, are at particular risk for producing major limb length discrepancies. Imagine sitting in a short, half-filled bathtub with your hands on your knees. The growth plates not submerged in the water, those at the shoulders, knees, and wrists, are the major contributors to longitudinal bone growth. Those submerged in water, the ones near the ankles and elbows, contribute less. What about instances of dwarfism or giantism, when growth plates are universally affected? Mammalian bones are genetically predetermined to grow to a certain size and then stop. The controlling factor is pituitary growth hormone. Too much of it, and activity in the growth plates rages. A pituitary gland tumor can send growth hormone levels soaring and lead to overgrowth. Such was the case for the iconic French wrestler and actor, Andre the Giant. Conversely, an underproduction of growth hormone results in short stature. The limbs and trunk of a person so affected will be normally proportioned, but just equally small in all respects. Tom Thumb comes to mind. Giving extra growth hormone to short-statured children is controversial, but it can boost growth plate activity and elevate stature into normal range. The same genetically predetermined limit to bone growth affecting mammals also occurs in birds. All adult sparrows of a given species are the same size. However, this is not the case for fish, amphibians, and reptiles. Their growth plates never close, and their bones continue to grow throughout their lives, although more slowly after sexual maturity. By logic, this might lead you to believe that the huge python you spot in the tree overhead is a grandparent, but that is only partly correct. These animals' ultimate size is largely determined not only by age, but also by the availability of food in its early life. With abundant prey, the python grew quickly during its early life, then continued to grow, but more slowly. To withstand strain on the body, whether by jogging, snowboarding, or lifting heavy loads, bones must also grow thicker as they grow longer, and they do so without the aid of growth plates. In this instance, the twig analogy holds. Twigs thicken into branches as layers under the bark add new wood, an additional ring every growing season. Our bones thicken in the same way, except that they do not show obvious growth rings. Under normal circumstances, bone growth continues year-round and does not accelerate in summer months. Still, bone does need sunshine, just not directly on it. Skin protects bone from such direct exposure and further aids bone by making vitamin D when exposed to sunlight. In turn, vitamin D facilitates the transfer of dietary calcium into the bloodstream. This system operates much like a bank, with money, calcium, officers, vitamin D, regulators, hormones, and its own Federal Reserve, parathyroid glands. Let me set the scene. Recall that calcium is the principal element in hydroxyapatite, the crystal that makes bone hard. In a dissolved state, calcium is also essential to other tissues, including nerve and muscle. For instance, the heart, a highly specialized muscle, suffers if it is not getting precisely the right level of calcium. Too much, it gets twitchy. Too little, it gets cramps. Either one is life-threatening, so the body has a finely tuned mechanism to keep the blood levels of calcium within the appropriate and narrow range. Glucose and carbon dioxide levels in our bloodstream can vary considerably, depending on when we last ate or how fast we breathe. But calcium levels normally never vary by more than 1 to 2%, akin to driving your car always at the same speed, regardless of road conditions. The heart, that prima donna, insists on it. So where does the calcium come from to keep the heart happy? If dietary intake is sufficient and steady, the needed calcium comes from what we eat and drink. But because none of us are likely to sip on calcium smoothies around the clock, our bones become a bank that loans calcium to the bloodstream and takes it back as conditions change. The bank's officers and regulators, vitamin D and several hormones, work together to keep the heart ticking happily, even if it means that the calcium reserves in our bones become depleted over time. When this happens, a banking crisis in the form of a fragility fracture can occur. The main calcium-regulating hormone comes from the four parathyroid glands, located in the neck. Their power far exceeds their bulk. They are about the same weight, size, and consistency as soggy cornflakes, and are pasted onto the thyroid gland midway between chin and breastbone. Consider these quadruplets to be the Federal Reserve of calcium, overseeing the calcium banking industry. The Fed constantly samples calcium levels in the blood. If an imbalance occurs, the parathyroid glands send hormonal orders to the gut, kidneys, and bone to delicately expand or contract the calcium level in the blood so that the heart can continue throbbing rhythmically and efficiently. Although bone has an adversarial relationship with the heart, the more calcium the heart takes in from the gut and other sources means fewer bone loans must be made to satisfy the pump's calcium needs. Accordingly, awareness of the body's natural processes should encourage us to get outside more and trigger the replenishment of vitamin D. Vitamin production by sunbathing, however, is less effective in the winter and is thwarted by sunblock, advancing age, and pigmentation. For these reasons, dairies add vitamin D to milk, and your doctor may advise you to take a vitamin D supplement. In adults, the calcium content of bone peaks around age 25 and then gradually diminishes, decade by decade. This waning accelerates dramatically in women after menopause. Weakened spine segments, which are originally short cylinders, can collapse into wedges, causing the back to bow, forming a dowager's hump. As conditions worsen, the inevitable diminution of balance, eyesight, and agility may lead to dangerous stumbles and falls. Broken hips and wrists in fragile bones abound, but still, the heart beats merrily away, blissfully unaware of the structural damage its hefty demands are causing. Even worse, the heart is oblivious to the fact that its safety depends on the rigidity of the bony cage that surrounds and protects it. Without sturdy ribs, spine, and breastbone, every hug would be a brutal squeeze.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.